people. Now, in our last session, we looked at why history hinges on the feast days and how the door in the middle of the menorah, the feast, just kind of swings back and forth on those golden hinges. And that is Shavuot or Pentecost. It's the feast in the middle branch of the menorah. And God brings his law and his spirit to the earth on this day of the year because we need both. We need both of those. And you know what? I think those lights are supposed to be off. Is it true? Okay. All right. We're going to turn those lights off. Because I can see better and you can see better when those lights are off. All right. Good. Thank you. Thank you, Cliff. I appreciate that. Okay. So Shavuot opens the door to God's redemptive plan through the spring feast, and then it closes the door to man's history on the earth through the fall feast. That's what we're going to look at. We're going to look at the fall feast tonight. They point back to Shavuot, which is the door of the law and the spirit. And they point back to Shavuot in the same way that the spring feasts point forward to Shavuot. Do you remember seeing the lamps that turned to the middle and all the wicks that leaned in toward the middle? That's what the feasts do. They all lean into this Shavuot. The fall feasts are also a prophetic roadmap. When we think about the events that we're waiting for on the calendar, we're going to see these unfold on the fall feast. The resurrection of the dead, the return of the Messiah. It's probably not in that order. We'll turn those around. And also the beginning of the messianic reign on earth, the judgment of the nations. Those are the things we're waiting for. Don't we want to see the Father punish his enemies? Don't we want to see him punish ours? But really, he loves our enemies. That's the story of Jonah. He loves our enemies. Okay. The feast days help us stay focused on what the real purpose of end-time prophecy is. The real purpose of end-time prophecy is to change our behavior, is to change us. There is a predictive aspect which can help us to be ready for the future, but it is primarily, first and foremost, something that's out there for the purpose of changing us. You know, if we can get our minds around what's coming, don't we want to stay close to him, close enough to him that we can hear his voice telling us whether to turn to the right or to the left? We do. We want that. And so prophecy kind of pushes us to get that close to him, to be that close to him. Now, the spring feasts in the first month of the year celebrate how God brought Israel into existence as a nation. He gave them physical freedom from Egypt in conjunction with the spring feasts. And the fall feasts are not about physical freedom, they're about spiritual freedom. Most of us don't live in an agricultural society anymore. Kind of sad, isn't it? We're very far removed from the farm which grows the food we eat. So we're not in an agrarian society. But that was not the case when the temple was standing. In Bible days, people were looking to the Creator for enough increase to sustain them. They had to rely on him. And this coincided with the fall feast days. These feasts come at the end of the growing season. Therefore, they portray the events which occur at the end of the age. End of the growing season, end of the age. You know, Yeshua talked about the fields being white unto harvest. That is a picture of the end of the age. And that's what they look like at the time of the fall feasts. And so it's looking forward prophetically to the end of the age. Now, in Israel and in Jewish communities today, Elul, the month which leads into the seventh month, and the seventh month is the time of all the fall feasts. This month of Elul that leads into that, that's where we were a month ago. And the time of the fall feasts themselves, it's a very trying time. We wouldn't think that, but what they understand is that each person is getting ready to be judged by God. They're going to be judged. And then on Tishri 1, which was last week, was that Monday night? Sunday night? Monday night? On Tishri 1, the trial intensifies, this time before a heavenly court. They believe that books are opened and that the destiny of each individual is being decided for the coming year. The synagogue is blasting the trumpet every day, and it is a real life call to repentance. For most people, this is a breathtaking, nail-biting vigil for mercy. Now, how much truth is there in this? You know, I don't want to dig into this too deeply because I want to go on and talk about the fall feast. But Scripture does say that God has more than one book. So when they think of the books being opened, Scripture says He has books. He has more than one book. All right, let's find out what Scripture really says about this season. Revelation 20, verse 4 is a compound verse, which addresses the prophetic fulfillment of all three fall feasts. All three fall feasts are in this one verse. Revelation 20, verse 4 states, "Then I saw thrones, and those seated on them received authority to judge. And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for testifying about Yeshua and proclaiming the word of God. Also those who had not worshipped the beast or its image and had not received the mark on their foreheads and on their hands. They came to life and ruled with the Messiah for 1,000 years. Now this is an amazing compound verse, and it has three parts. Each section is a prophetic description of one of the fall feasts. The first section of Revelation 20, verse 4 states, "Then I saw thrones, and those seated on them received authority to judge." Okay, talking about a courtroom, talking about a trial situation, and the people have the authority to judge. This refers to Yom Kippur. Since Yom Kippur was a judgment day at the temple, a future Yom Kippur brings the judgment of the nations. Then in the second section of Revelation 20, verse 4, it states, "And I saw the souls of those who had been beheaded for testifying about Yeshua and proclaiming the word of God. Also those who had not worshipped the beast or its image and had not received the mark on their foreheads and on their hands. They came to life." This is about resurrection. So this refers to a future feast of trumpets, because the dead resurrect to a trumpet blast, according to Isaiah and the Brit Hadashah, or New Testament. Now, in the third section of Revelation 20, verse 4, it states, "And ruled with the Messiah for 1,000 years. This describes a future kingdom. Someone's ruling. Someone's co-ruling. Someone has authority in the kingdom. So the future Feast of Tabernacles is when the Messiah begins to reign in the Messianic kingdom. And all of the imagery is there for that, and we're going to see that in this session. All of these prophetic events are still in the future and untold. All of these prophetic events are still to come, but they will unfold on the fall feast days. We're going to examine their prophetic significance, beginning with the first one. The Feast of Trumpets is the first fall feast. It is called Yom Teruah in Numbers 29:1, which means Day of the Awakening Blast. Now that's a trumpet blast that wakes somebody up. Who do you think that trumpet blast is waking up? It was a memorial of trumpet blowing at the temple because God wanted people to listen to shofar blasts. It is a holiday of firsts for many reasons. It is the first fall feast and the first day of the High Holy Days, according to Leviticus 23:24. Then it is the first day of the Hebrew New Year, based on 1 Kings 8:2. It is the anniversary of creation, according to tradition. It is the birthday of Adam, or Adam, according to tradition. It is also the day when Abraham bound Isaac on the altar. That's also according to tradition. You'll find that in the footnotes of your Homash for Genesis 22. It is the wedding of the Messiah with his bride, based on Jeremiah 25:10 and Matthew 25:1-4. It is the day of the throne, Yom HaKisa, K-I-S-A. It means day of the throne. And the coronation of the Messiah as King of Kings, based on 1 Kings 1:39 and Psalm 47:6-8. It is also the first and only feast to occur on a new moon. It is the resurrection of the dead, based on Isaiah 18:3, 1 Corinthians 15:52, 1 Thessalonians 4:16, and the Talmud, Rosh Hashanah 16b. Now, that's so interesting that the writings of the rabbis agree with what we've got in the New Testament. But they do. On this point, they do. Okay, let's take these points one by one, because these are pretty serious things. The Feast of Trumpets is considered to be the new year. After the Babylonian exile, it became known as Rosh Hashanah, which means head of the year. Autumn really was the beginning of the year for the ancient people. Solomon dedicated the first temple in the autumn. In the month of Ethanim is what it says in 1 Kings 8:2. Now, if you look at that in the Targum Bible, are you all familiar with the Targum at all? Let me tell you just a little bit about it, because it's a wonderful online resource for you. I'll spell it first of all. It's T-A-R-G-U-M, and it looks like tar and gum. And for years, I thought it was Targum. I thought it was the Targum Bible. I said that on TV, and only later did I find out it's Targum. That's how it's pronounced. Well, that is a 2,200-year-old Amplified Bible, written in Aramaic, and it's been translated into English. Now, you can go to T-A-R-G-U-M, Targum, or Targum.com, I think. Targum.com is what it is. No, wait a minute. No, it's targum.info. And you can go there and you can actually read all of the Torah in a 2,200-year-old version. It's a version that the disciples were familiar with. And they have got the most wonderful footnotes in this Bible. You know, they have a Babylonian Targum, which was written in Babylon. And everyone thinks that's the most authoritative one. Then there's a pseudo Jonathan Targum, which was written in the land of Israel, or in the Middle East, in Palestine is what they say. So they've got a footnote for 1 Kings 8:2. When we read in our Bibles that Solomon dedicated the temple in the month of Ethanim, don't you kind of wonder what that is? But a footnote in the Targum Bible translation for this verse defines the word Ethanim, and this is what it says. Ethanim is the month that the ancient ones called the first month, but now it's called the seventh month. So for ancient people, autumn really was the beginning of the year. It really was. And so for these ancient people, the Feast of Trumpets really was the anniversary of creation, because they believed the world began at this time of year. This is the anniversary. It was the birthday of Adam and the day that Abraham bound Isaac on the altar, and that's how they saw this holiday. Although the Bible doesn't give specific dates for these events, the Hebrew people believe they coincide with the new year. And it's the Father's pattern to do that. You know, he makes multiple things happen on the same day of the year. The idea that I was radically saved on the 26th of Tammuz, and then I was radically brought to the feast and the Sabbath against my will, also on the 26th of Tammuz, same day of the year. And that's what he does. So if the ancients say this, I'm not going to say they're wrong. I'm going to say I'll find out more. I'll find out more, because it could be true. All right, now, this feast is also connected with the wedding of the Messiah, based on Jeremiah 25:10 and Matthew 25, 1 through 4. Jeremiah 25:10 speaks of the voice of the bride and the bridegroom and the lighting of lamps. Now that's a little bit of a picture into the Hebrew wedding. You know, there's whole books out there on the Hebrew wedding because the imagery of the traditional Hebrew wedding is how we're going to see the Messiah return for us. The bridegroom always comes at night. That's why the lighting of the lamps. That's why the maidens get left out, and they don't look too happy back there. They're kind of scowling, and it's like, what? Are you kidding? I waited all my life for this, and now I can't go into the wedding chamber? The bridegroom comes at night, and Hebrew weddings occurred at night. Now, the bridegroom prepared the wedding chamber, when his father approved the chamber, then he married the bride. He would take his attendants, and he would go for the bride, and it would be at midnight, in the dark of night. In the parable of the bridesmaids in Matthew 25, they're holding lamps as they wait for him because it's really dark outside. He comes in the middle of the night, and the Feast of Trumpets occurred on the darkest night of any feast. No other feast is as dark as this one in terms of what it's like at nighttime. At Passover, there's a full moon. At the beginning of Tabernacles, there's a full moon. Not this one. It's a new moon. Okay, this is also the day of the throne and the coronation of the Messiah as King of Kings, based on 1 Kings 139 and Psalm 47, 6 through 8. So let me just tell you about those two verses briefly. 1 Kings 139 is the coronation of Solomon. And it explains how they took him down to the Kidron Brook, probably for a mikveh, and then they blew the shofar, they anointed him with oil, and he was king over Israel. So it involved a trumpet blast. Psalm 47, 6 through 8 is more prophecy. It's not about past history like the 1 Kings verse. It's prophecy that the God will be enthroned to the sound of a trumpet blast, that he will come down, he will be enthroned to the sound of a trumpet blast. So there's the prophecy right there, the Psalm 47. Now, this is also the only festival occurring on a new moon. This feast became a two-day feast in Bible times because people were uncertain about the new moon. No one knew with 100% accuracy when it had occurred. Once a month, the moon passes between the earth and the sun, and at an exact moment, it is completely in earth's shadow. And this darkened moon is what we call a new moon. Today, computers calculate the exact time of the new moon, but in Bible days, it wasn't so easy, especially if it was cloudy outside. Because the moon travels around the earth in 29 and a half days, we end up with months that begin on the 29th or the 30th day. Because of this, the exact moment when the new moon commences and the festival begins is hard to determine. In Jerusalem, two witnesses would search the skies trying to spot the first little sliver of the new moon. Do I have my picture up there? Yes. I love that picture. They would report their sighting to the Sanhedrin, who would officially declare the new month, because the new month would begin on the new moon. And they would declare it by holding up a lighted torch, and then a priest on the roof over there in one of the towers. Can we go back a slide? The other priest on the roof would hold up his torch. And then the trumpeters would announce the new moon with trumpet blasts. Here's where they stood. This drawing shows where the trumpeter stood at the southwest corner of the Temple Mount. It's actually my favorite place in Jerusalem. There is an actual stone section from this that the Romans pushed off when they destroyed the temple, and it was down on the ground, and it was under 2 and 3 ton blocks of stone. So it was there till about 20 years ago. It was there for 2,000 years, and they found it. And it says, to the place of trumpeting. And that's the actual section. It's in the British Museum. That is the actual section that was on that little area where the trumpeter stood to blast his trumpet at the new moon. So when this, let's Let's recap this. The witnesses would see it. They would tell the Sanhedrin. The Sanhedrin approved it. They lit their torches. Then the trumpeters blasted. Now, men were on the mountains all around Jerusalem with bonfires ready to light. The wood was all stacked up. You know, they were good Boy Scouts, and they knew just how to put the kindling on the bottom and put the bigger wood up on top. And when they heard the trumpets blasting, they would light their signal fires. They would light these roaring signal fires. And then the people waiting on the next ring of mountains outside Jerusalem would see the fires, and they would light their signal fires. And this would go on all night. All night. And then finally, at the last mountain, they would dispatch relay runners who would run to all the distant places that the Jewish people lived to let them know that the new month had begun. So it was a long night of lighting fires and sending runners out to tell everybody. So the Jews were living, we know where they were living. They were living in Babylon because a lot of them did not come home. They were living in Babylon. They were living in Iran. They were living in Turkey. They were living in Egypt. Huge Jewish population in Alexandria, Egypt. And so they had to wait to know that the new month had begun. Now, this happened every single month. They didn't have cell phones. They did not have computers. They did not have meteorologists. They had to see it with their eyes and approve it, because Scripture described that the new month would begin on the new moon. So this is how they acted it out. They're just acting out Scripture in the best way they could. Now, this was absolutely fascinating because it happened on every new moon. But it was especially important on the Feast of Trumpets, because the holiday could not begin until the month started. If it's on the first day of the month. It's the only feast day on the first day of a month. Okay. Now, this one-day feast became a two-day feast to give everyone time to start the month, because it took a while to do all that. Can you imagine running to Egypt or running to Nineveh just to get the word out? So this one-day feast became a two-day feast for that reason, to give everyone time to start the month. Now, these 2 days were known as one long day, and it was one long day that was actually 2 days. You see? That's important, as you will soon find out. That is so important. Only the Feast of Trumpets, the day of the awakening blast, occurs on a new moon on a day and at an hour which no one knows. Okay. Finally, the Feast of Trumpets coincides with the resurrection of the dead. We expect a future Feast of Trumpets to bring the resurrection of the dead, and this is based on Scripture. Isaiah 18:3 speaks to the inhabitants of the earth, telling them to listen for the shofar when they're going to awaken. Then 1 Corinthians 15:51 and 52 explains, "Behold, I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised incorruptible, and we will be changed." Then in 1 Thessalonians 4:16, it says, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the chief angel, and with God's shofar. The dead in the Messiah will rise first." Now, a trumpet is code language for the Feast of Trumpets. A shofar appears on some Jewish tombstones for this reason, because the Hebrew people expect an awakening blast to awaken the dead. You know, my mother-in-law of blessed memory used to take us all on these trips. She made us go to Belgium, and she made us go to France, and she made us go to Italy, and she would take us on all these trips because she was an educator. And she used to say, "I'm spending your inheritance. I'm taking you on these trips." And so she took us to Belgium, and she made us, she said, "Here's the deal. I'll take you to Belgium, I'll take you to Holland, but you have to go to Flanders Fields, and that's really old school. Flanders Fields are the battlefields from World War I. So we walked around those battlefields of World War I, and we learned all the history. We did all that because she said we had to. And as I looked, wherever the Jewish soldiers were buried, I knew them in two ways. Some of them had shofars on the tombstones, and some of them, all of them, had little rocks on top. So I got a little rock, and I put it up on everyone that I could, too. And you know what that rock means? The word for rock is aven, which is a combination of Av and Ben, father and son. So when you put a rock on a Jewish tombstone, you're telling them, I agree to be part of your family. I will keep your memory alive. I will be part. It will be as if I am your father or your son. So that's why they do it. Remember I told you how much they are brothers? They're a family. And so that's what you'll see on Jewish tombstones. But look for the shofar, because they put the shofar on the tombstones. Now, the question we should be asking is this. Can the dead resurrect on the Feast of Trumpets and Matthew 24:36 still be true? This verse states, but of that day and hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but only my Father. This is perhaps the most misunderstood verse in Scripture. Potentially. If we ask believers what this verse means, 99.9% are going to say that we cannot know the timing of the return of the Messiah. They often take this verse to its logical conclusion and think that Yeshua can return at any time, whether or not prophecy has been fulfilled. Can he come at just any time? No. Remember, it's not up to him. And our God is a God of order. Okay. The dead resurrect at his return. It is true that there is a great mystery surrounding the resurrection of the dead. There is also a mystery surrounding the timing of the Feast of Trumpets. Yeshua said in Matthew 24:36 that no man would know the day or the hour of his return. This was a clue which his followers understood from the feast days. His return is associated with the uncertain timing of trumpets, of Yom Teruah, the day of the awakening blast. It's associated with the new moon of this feast. Because this feast is both one day long and 2 days long, guess what? He can come back on a day that only the Father knows. It could still be one of these days, and we don't know which one. Only the Father knows. It can still be at a day and an hour that only he knows. Another clue about resurrection on the Feast of Trumpets comes from Peter. 2 Peter 3:10 explains, but the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. This expression, thief in the night, have you heard that before? It connects the day of the Lord with Yom Teruah, the only feast day which occurs on the darkest night, at an unknown hour and day. Now, the thief in the night was also the name for the supervisor at the temple. And I bet some of you know this already. This is just absolutely fascinating. This phrase was a reference to the captain of the temple guard. It was very important for the temple guards to keep watch. If they fell asleep while guarding the temple, looters could steal the gold and silver from the temple, or far worse, they could steal the sacred fire off the altar, because that fire was supposed to be kept burning all the time. And so, you know, when I was just brand new, just a baby in the military, I already had a college degree. I don't even know what I was doing in there. But my very first night at my permanent duty station, I got guard duty. And I had to stay up all night, and I was tired. I was really tired. Really, really tired. Did I fall asleep on guard duty? Yes, I did. Yes, I did. And I was at the battalion headquarters building, so I was inside. I wasn't out walking a perimeter somewhere, although that's something all of us need to learn to do. Really and truly, we can talk about that later. I've got some thoughts on that. We need to secure the perimeter. I absolutely believe in that. But I was in the headquarters building. So I went to sleep listening to old school rock and roll. And when I woke up, there was a sleepy little Mexican Tejano station playing. And I started crying and I thought, I'm at the end of the world. Because I was in Texas, and oh my gosh, what was I listening to? Could not believe it. But when these guards at the temple fell asleep, oh, it was really, really bad. I think there was a lot more at stake at the temple than there was in that headquarters building long, long ago. So the fire had to stay burning on the altar. Imagine someone coming to steal that fire. Or to steal the silver and gold, because the temple was a repository for people, for precious coins and jewels. They could put their money on deposit at the temple, and they did. And they also, you know, the temple also had a treasury where they were collecting constantly to pay for the sacrifices and to maintain the temple complex. So there were lots of valuables at the temple. Now, the captain of the temple guard made his rounds to repeatedly check on the Levite guards. So some Levites get to be musicians and some have to stand guard at the doors. And I've been told, and I want to research this more, that the gate or the door that you guarded at the temple as a Levite, that was inherited and went down through your family line. And only a male descendant in that family could guard that door. So this was very, very important. He had to make certain that no Levite guarding the temple would neglect his duty and fall asleep at his post like I did a long time ago. The captain greeted each guard. If the guard was awake, he returned his greeting. If not, the guard was asleep on duty. If he found him sleeping, he would wrap him with a stick and he would set his robe on fire. The shame of a burned robe, coupled with the fear of being burned, generally kept the priests, the Levites, awake on their watch. And so for the Levite who was awake, the coming of the captain or the thief in the night was a friendly and expected visit. But if the guard was asleep, his master's arrival would be terrifying. The captain of the guard was the thief in the night because he was going to steal his garments, his priestly robe. He was going to set it on fire. You know, I love that passage. I've got this in the feast book. I didn't put it in my notes, so let me try to remember it. I think it's 1 Corinthians 3:15. I think that's where it is. But it talks about how if you don't build with precious silver and gold, and your works are wood, hay, and stubble, you will be saved, but your works will be burned up. You will be saved, but as if through fire. And in my mind, I see that Levite running with his clothes on fire and then trying to get the fire out, probably drop and roll. Didn't we all learn drop and roll in elementary school? To get the fire out on his clothes. His works would be burned up. In other words, he did not do a good job at his guard post. He did not do a good job at his guard post. And he would live, but he would live and be saved as if through fire. So that verse reminds me, and I think Rabbi Paul was talking about this thief at the night at the temple. So when the captain, here's what I believe about this. This is an easy one. It's not always easy to do, but it is a lesson, and it's an easy lesson to get. Yeshua is the captain of God's house. We must stay alert and watch for the signs of his coming, because he will come, as Peter said, as a thief in the night. He's going to come as a captain of God's house. And if we're guarding the kingdom, if we're guarding God's house, he's going to see, what are you doing? Are you asleep? Are you asleep at the wheel? Are you asleep on duty? Are you diligently watching for me? Okay, so we must stay alert and watch for the signs of his coming. We can think about what the Bible says and be awake to its clues. Then when the captain of God's house comes back, it will be exactly when we expect him. And we will be ready, and he will come as our friend and not as a thief. If we choose to neglect what the Bible says and be mentally asleep, he will come as a thief in the night. We will be injured if we fall asleep spiritually. What's that old school song? Stay awake, ye saints of the Lord. Don't slumber while the end is nearing. Now, I don't want to dissect that theologically, but it's a great reminder. Stay awake, because this is not a dress rehearsal. This is the real thing. And we will be injured if we fall asleep spiritually. The themes of the Feast of Trumpets are evident in the seven trumpets of Revelation, the seven trumpet judgments, which serve to announce God's judgments. He must destroy his enemies. You know, that's hard to believe, because he loves our enemies, but he'll destroy his. It's true. Luke 19:27 is a parable about a king, but it's also a description of what Yeshua will do when he is crowned King of Kings in the Messianic age. This verse says, "But as for these enemies of mine who did not want me to reign over them, bring them here and slaughter them before me." It's hard to imagine Yeshua saying this, but he will. And he is returning with a sword in his mouth. He will say this. Okay, prophecies. To summarize the prophecies, which are fulfilled on a future Feast of Trumpets. Let's see. Okay. The first is the resurrection of the dead. And we know that's related to trumpet blasts, according to Isaiah 18:3, 1 Corinthians 15:51 and 52, and 1 Thessalonians 4:16. But I also think Matthew 24:31 is in there. I didn't write it down. But that's another one where it says that he will dispatch his angels to the four corners of the earth. They'll go at the sound of a trumpet blast, and they will gather the elect. Gather the elect. Okay, the Messiah is crowned King of Kings with trumpet blasts, according to Psalm 47, 6 through 8. And then the Messiah bridegroom comes for the bride on the darkest night, like the night of the new moon, according to Matthew 25, 1 through 4. And the lesson for us is that we must stay alert and watch diligently for his coming. We must be watching when he comes. We must be watching. All right, now Yom Kippur is the next fall feast. It comes on the 10th day of the 7th month. It's not a feast day. It's a fast day, a day for fasting. There are many reasons to fast. We may fast when our hearts feel heavy about something. We may fast because we want God to hear our prayers. We may fast before surgery or a colonoscopy. But these are all fasts that we choose. Yom Kippur, on the other hand, is a fast that God chooses. Yom means day. Kippur means to cover. So this is a day of covering, or the day of atonement. This was the only day of the year when the sins of Israel as a nation were covered. Yom Kippur was the only day of the year the high priest went into the Holy of Holies with blood to atone for sin. Ancient Israel's fate hung in the balance on this day. The nation needed the blood atonement of the Yom Kippur sacrifices, because that was God's prescription. That's all they had until Yeshua was born. Or they risked God's divine judgment on the entire nation. An entire chapter in the Bible, Leviticus 16, is devoted to the service, or the avodah, of the high priest on Yom Kippur. It describes all of it, and I just double dare you to go read it, because it is so confusing. And when I was writing the feast book, I'm telling you, I would read it and read it and read it and read it, but until I opened the Mishnah, which is the rabbinical SOP, standard operating procedure. I didn't know how they fulfilled what those verses said. I didn't know the order in which they took the incense, the order in which he immersed in a mikvah five times that day. I didn't know the exact order, but I learned it in the Mishnah. Leviticus 16 tells us what? The Mishnah tells us how. In the tractate called Yoma, which means it's from Yom or day, the day, the day. And if in any time you see the word the day, it's Yom Kippur. Anytime you see the word the fast, like in Acts 27 verse 9, it's Yom Kippur. Now the Hebrew sages, as I said, wrote that how-to manual for that day and told exactly how they did it. So I had to use that to write that Yom Kippur chapter in the feast book. And I've got all those steps all on one page. And it is a phenomenal amount of detailed service that they had to do before the Lord at the temple that day. Now, Their SOP for how to do it, their standard, their instruction manual, if you will, for how to do Yom Kippur, included appointing an emergency substitute for the high priest. Can you hear me? I do not know why it's doing that. Is there a chance the battery isn't fresh, or is it something I'm doing? Here comes Cliff. Or he's talking about it. He's thinking about it. Okay, let's see how far we can get on this mic. Okay, the SOP, the instruction manual, or the standard operating procedure for Yom Kippur, included appointing a substitute for the high priest. They both had to move to the temple compound for a week before Yom Kippur. No being home with mama, no home-cooked meals, nothing like that. You had to be sanctified for Yom Kippur. Thank you. Now, did you all know that about 3 weeks ago, maybe four, they appointed the high priest? It's true. He's a young guy. He's just like Michael. He's got peyos. He's got some curly cues. But he's a young guy. He's just full of passion and fire. They appointed him about 4 weeks ago. Do a Google search. You're going to be surprised. So he's ready. They've appointed the high priest. Okay. All right. So they had to have a substitute. So if the high priest could not perform all the sacrifices of that day and all those steps he had to do, and there are probably 20 steps, and each one of them, on each one of those steps, hung the future of Israel. It was that critical. This was a Shabbat Shabbaton, and it means Sabbath of Sabbaths. This was the most holy day of the year, and it still is for Israel. This is still the most holy day of the year. Okay, so that substitute would have to step in, and he would be shadowing him all week. And the high priest didn't normally do the sacrifices. I don't know if you all knew that, but all the other priests did the sacrifices. He did the Yom Kippur sacrifices. So he had to get in the swing. He did the daily tamid, which is the morning lamb and the evening lamb. It's the daily burnt offering, to get into the practice of doing it. Now, so he had a substitute. Now, for the high priest to atone for Israel on this day, he had to lay aside his royal, majestic garments. But they're so cool, I have to show them to you anyway. They were not actually humble enough for him to wear inside the Holy of Holies, where the divine presence of God was. So what did he wear in there? White linen. It's why the righteous receive white linen in Revelation. It's from Yom Kippur. Okay, so only pure white linen would do on the Day of Atonement. But I want to show you his majestic garments because they're wonderful. And if we're familiar with these, we understand that they were making a spiritual statement. The colors and the materials in these are all symbolic. His blue robe was dyed with dye taken from a chilazon snail. And as they do archaeology in Israel today, you know, if I had a second and parallel career and we could roll back about 40 years, I'd be a biblical archaeologist. I would love to dig in the dirt in Israel and prove that Scripture is true. Well, they dug under a home that was a priestly home in the old city of Jerusalem, and they found down underneath the rubble of this house all these chilazon snail shells. So they know the snail, and it had little holes drilled into the shells where they were extracting the blue dye for this rope. Now, take a look at his hem. Tiny golden bells are alternating with blue, purple, and scarlet pomegranates, and each one of these colors have a meaning. Blue represents heavenly authority, purple is royalty, scarlet is like the color of blood, so it represents redemption. Now, each item also had spiritual significance. The bells of gold were a symbol of God's holiness. Now, this is based on Zechariah 14:20, and Zechariah 14:20 is the very last verse of Zechariah. That's in the little passage that tells us there's going to be sacrifices in the future, and where it says that all the cooking pots in Jerusalem will be holy to the Lord. It also says that all the bells on the harnesses of the horses will have holy to the Lord written on them, meaning everything that lives in Jerusalem when Messiah reigns on earth will be holy to him. So the bells represent holy to the Lord, or holiness to the Lord. All right, and then the pomegranates signify God's word. Can someone tell me why? I know y'all know this. Yes, it supposedly has 613 seeds, one for every mitzvot in the Torah. And so that represents the word. So holiness, word, holiness, word, holiness, word, right there across the hem of the garment. Now, there is one thing about this, and I'll have to talk with someone at the Temple Institute about this. I'm sure they're on it because they're pretty sharp guys. But after they made the high priest's garment, the blue robe with this hem, after they did it, they found a bell. They found a bell. And it's been in the last 6-7 years. They found a bell, and they believe it's from the high priest's robe, and it doesn't look like these. These look like the bell in Philadelphia. And you know, one of the big guys at the Temple Institute is from America. So naturally he's thinking Philadelphia Liberty Bell. That bell does not look like that. The bell they found is flat, it has two sides, and it's scalloped like a shell. It's like a shell. And you know, when you go to the beach, those flat shells that are kind of dark purple and they're white in the middle, if you put two of those together, it looks a little bit like that. Okay, now let's look at the weaving, because on top of his robe he wore a breastplate, but the slide that I have for the breastplate is not a good slide. So I wanted to show you this one, because this is a very good slide. This shows us up close what the ephod looked like. It was woven of blue, purple, and scarlet yarn with threads of pure gold. Now, they've actually made this. And when they made the robe, I know you all have heard all of this. It's still fascinating to think about. When they made the blue robe, they needed to do it with a box stitch. And I'll have to go back and read all the instructions in Exodus to know if that was scripture or if that came from the Mishnah, that's how they made the robe. And they looked across the world and they couldn't find anyone who knew how to do a box stitch, how to weave, how to knit a box stitch with that kind of, with linen thread. And they found someone in the Navajo tribe in Arizona. So it was someone from the Navajos who made the blue robe for the high priest. Okay. All right, now his turban, we know he wore a turban and had a gold plate in front that said, "Holy to Yahweh, holy to Yod-Heh-Vav-Heh, holy to the Lord." And here's his full outfit. In the days of the temple, I think this outfit could strike a healthy fear in the Israelites. If you saw this coming down the street, wouldn't you be afraid? He had authority. He had the greatest authority in the land. So, he inspired a little bit of fear in the Israelites, and even Rabbi Paul respected his authority and apologized to him in Acts 23:5 for criticizing the high priest. He wasn't wearing these clothes, and he didn't know he was the high priest. Dressed only in white linen, the high priest was just as awe-inspiring, I believe. That's what he needed to go into the Holy of Holies. But dressed only in white linen, I think he was just as awe-inspiring for the people. As he slaughtered the sacrifices of Yom Kippur, he began with the bull. The high priest laid his hands on the head of a bull to confess his sins and the sins of his family. So the bull received the sins of the priesthood. Then he turned his attention to two goats. One was sacrificed, the other was the scapegoat, and which would symbolically carry away Israel's sins to Azazel. It is mentioned in Leviticus 16:21 as a predetermined place in the wilderness. Returning to the bull, he would cut its throat and collected its blood in a special golden vessel known as a mitzrach vessel. And when I have a lot of time and I spend 2 hours just teaching Yom Kippur, I show you all these because I've got a really great slide of this mitzrach vessel. It didn't have a bottom on it, so when they handed it to a little junior priest, he had to agitate it like this. He could never set it down. It's cone-shaped on the bottom, made out of gold. He could never set it down. He had to keep the blood agitated. So he cut its throat, collected its blood, and another priest agitated the blood until he took the incense inside the Holy of Holies. The high priest gathered the burning embers from the altar of burnt offering to take inside the temple. He took the coals and the golden chalice of incense, and he ascended the temple steps. It was time for him to enter the Holy of Holies for the first time in a year. He cautiously threaded his way around the heavy curtains, and I know about the teaching about him being translated through the curtain, and that could be, but I don't see that in Hebrew writings. I don't see that. I haven't seen that in historical writings. So he makes his way in there. The important thing is he's in there. It's a scary place to be. The divine presence was over the ark, and approaching God without incense would have been disrespectful. What does the incense represent? Prayers. Prayers of the saints. So he was going in there as an intercessor. He was bringing in the prayers of Israel before the Father. He set the fire pan on the floor before the ark and placed the incense on the coals, and then the clouds of fragrant smoke filled the air. As he returned outside, he did not turn his back on the ark. What did he do? He backed away from it like this. He did not turn his back on the ark. It was more respectful to back away from it. When you go to the Western Wall today, what do you see? People pray at the wall and then they back away from it because it's the closest they can get to the Holy of Holies. Okay, the high priest returned into the Holy of Holies with blood, the blood of a bull. He sprinkled the ground 7 times before the ark. Now, legend says that he wore a rope around his ankle so that if he perished in there, inside the Holy of Holies, they could pull him out without going in there to get him. Back outside in the courtyard, he slaughtered the goat. He went back inside the Holy of Holies with the blood of the goat. Now, the goat atoned for the sins of the people, while the bull atoned for the sins of the priest. Now it was time to mix the bull's blood and the goat's blood together. Doesn't this seem like an odd thing to do? But this is in the Bible. This is what Leviticus 16 told him to do. I like the picture, though, because if the goat atones for the people and the bull atones for the priest, and you mix the blood of both of them together, it's a picture of the priesthood of believers. Puts the priest and the people together in one offering. Once mixed, this blood had a special purpose. He sprinkled the mixed blood on the curtain and on the altars. He started with the curtain. He atoned for the curtain in front of the Holy of Holies. And we see the high priest doing that here. He then consecrated all four horns of the altar of incense with the mixed blood. In this way, he fulfilled all the instructions in Leviticus 16. He also did the four horns of the altar of the great altar of burnt offering outside in the courtyard. But I don't have a picture of that. Now, the Bible is a wonderful manual. So when we're in doubt, all we have to do is read the manual. Other priests carried the carcasses of the bull and the goat outside the city to burn. Some people went with them just to watch. The high priest had sacrificed a bull for his sins. He had sacrificed a goat for the sins of the common people. And the picture of burning the sacrifice outside the city gates points to Yeshua. Hebrews 13:12 states, "So Yeshua also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood." Outside the gate. Now, there was one thing that he still had to do. The second goat had been waiting all this time. This was the scapegoat, and the scapegoat had to carry away Israel's sin. The high priest went to him, laid his hands on its head, and confessed the nation's sins, transferring Israel's guilt. Then another priest led the scapegoat into the wilderness. It was a great privilege to do this, but I cannot imagine a priest doing this when everybody's fasting food and water, going out into the Judean wilderness where it can get 130 degrees. Probably not at this time of year, but it can get hot out there. And for him, he went 90 ris, R-I-S is what the feast book says. He went, and it's true. I've got to give me one of those. Really, when every feast comes around, I have to go to that book and just double check. But he went 90 ris into the wilderness, and that actually comes from the Mishnah, and that is about 12 miles. So who could walk 12 miles in the desert with no food and no water? But it was a great privilege to do this. He took that scapegoat out there, and this was a joyful event for everyone because it was a picture of their sins being removed. The priest had to push the goat backward with his own hands. The scapegoat was pushed off of a cliff into the abyss to meet its fate. He was dashed to pieces on jagged rocks below. The casting of the scapegoat into the abyss prophetically looks forward to the casting of the adversary, the devil, Hasatan, into the lake of fire in Revelation 20, verse 10. That's a prophetic picture. Now, the high priest was finishing his duties at the temple. With great ceremony, he read Leviticus 16 and Numbers 29 from the temple steps as a testimony that he had followed all the biblical instructions. He slipped back into the Holy of Holies for the golden fire pan. Then he immersed for his fifth mikvah of the day. He donned his street clothes and he headed home. Now, we're probably wondering why. Why were there so many intricate steps required on Yom Kippur? Blood sacrifices are serious business. Leviticus 17:11 explains this. "For the life of the flesh is in the blood, and I have given it to you on the altar to make atonement for your souls, for it is the blood that makes atonement by the life." When we understand this verse, we understand why Yeshua had to die. Only blood can cover sin. So let's ask ourselves a question. If Yeshua has already died, does Yom Kippur have a purpose for us today? It took me years to answer that question for myself. It's always right to repent and to fast if the Holy Spirit leads us to do so. It's always right. Yom Kippur also points to future judgment. In Revelation 11:19, the vision of Yom Kippur occurs immediately after the seventh trumpet. And what this verse tells us is John looked and heaven opened and he could see into the Holy of Holies in heaven. And the ark was in there. So that's a vision of Yom Kippur. Only on Yom Kippur would anyone see the ark. So there is a parallel between future end times prophecy and Yom Kippur. The Holy of Holies, as I said, opened in the heavenly temple, clearly alluding to Yom Kippur, because this was the only feast day when the high priest could see it. Now, who is the high priest of Yom Kippur today? Yeshua. That's what the book of Hebrews is about. The book of Hebrews is written in the language of Yom Kippur. The book of Revelation is written in the language of the Feast of Tabernacles. Hebrews 6:20 tells us that he's the high priest. He intercedes for us not with the blood of bulls and goats, but with his own blood. And he does not atone yearly like the high priest at the temple. He atones once for all time. Hallelujah. Because Yom Kippur was a judgment day at the temple, a future Yom Kippur will be a time of judgment. God will fulfill this awe-inspiring festival on a future Yom Kippur as he judges sin and destroys his adversaries. After this, a great trumpet will blow, and it is a reminder of the beginning of the year of Jubilee. You know, the year of Jubilee started on Yom Kippur. Isn't that wonderful? At sunset on Yom Kippur, Leviticus 25, 9 and 10 is where you'll find that. They would blow a trumpet and the year of Jubilee would begin every 50th year. And I'm not going to argue about whether it's 50 or 49. That's one of the arguments out there. At predetermined intervals, the trumpet would blow and the year of Jubilee would begin on Yom Kippur. Now, a future Yom Kippur will bring the blowing of a great trumpet. The judgment will be over by the time the trumpet of a future Yom Kippur blows. It'll be wonderful. There are three prophetic trumpet blasts in Scripture. God blew the first trumpet at Mount Sinai before giving the Ten Commandments. We're going to find that in Exodus 19:16. He blows the last trumpet on a future feast of trumpets when the dead resurrect. Those passages come from the New Testament. He will blow the great trumpet on a future Yom Kippur, according to Isaiah 27:13, Zechariah 9:14, and Matthew 24:31. And I'll just tell you what those verses say. I love the one in Isaiah 27:13. When I found it, the first time I found it and saw its connection with Yom Kippur, I started weeping. Because it says, those who are perishing in Assyria and those who are just nearly gone in Egypt, he's going to gather them. And he's going to bring them back to Jerusalem to worship on his holy mountain. So it's about gathering his people wherever they are. It's about bringing them back to Jerusalem, bringing them back to Israel. And so is Matthew 24:31, which says he sends his angels out to gather the elect from the four corners. They go as in a trumpet blast. And then Zechariah 9:14 is about the whirlwind from the south. I never liked that reference, but the rabbis think that that's a reference to a future feast or to a future Yom Kippur, and so it's about the Lord arising in the whirlwind of the south and the trumpet blowing. So there is a great freedom coming at the end of a future Yom Kippur. In the meantime, those days between the Feast of Trumpets and Yom Kippur, the High Holy Days, are going to be very interesting days in some future year. Very interesting days. But at the end of Yom Kippur, all the judgment is finished. And the Messiah will prepare for the Messianic Kingdom on the earth. It is described in the last fall feast. The Feast of Tabernacles is the final fall feast, and it's known as the season of our joy. It looks forward to the joyous messianic age to come. 2,000 years ago, when Yeshua lived, pilgrims came to Jerusalem for Sukkot as a seven-day vacation with God. It was just like coming for Passover. Tabernacles or Sukkot was a pilgrim feast. You know, every Hebrew male had to go up to Jerusalem 3 times a year for the pilgrim feast. Deuteronomy told them to. But just now try to imagine that you're in their little homes where they live all over Israel. You can just hear their wives saying, "Well, you're going to take me, aren't you? I have been here all year. I've got things to do in Jerusalem. I've got things to buy. I'm tired of being here. I'm tired of these animals. I'm tired of these kids. You had better take me to Jerusalem with you." So men usually brought their families along with them because the women had to get out of the house. It was a mandatory spiritual retreat for men. And if God needed to do something in a man's heart, he could do that at a pilgrim feast. That's when God did business with men. Most of the men, as I said, brought their families along. Now, they brought their first fruits offering from their herds and their crops. You know, this was confusing for me for a long time, trying to understand the difference between first fruits and tithes. The tithes were not carried to Jerusalem. They went to the Levites in the Levitical cities. You're going to find this in Nehemiah 10:37. The tithes went to the Levites in the Levitical cities, wherever they lived, and the first fruits came to Jerusalem. You know, I think there's a beautiful picture there. I just now thought of it. That Yeshua is the firstborn of the Father. He's the firstborn from the dead. So why not be in a city that's always been devoted to firstborns or first fruits? Ha by Kareem. First fruits, because he's a Messiah of first fruits. That's who he is. So the tithes did not go to Jerusalem. The first fruits came. They brought their first fruits offerings from their herds and crops, and everyone looked for their very best animals and produce so they could offer God their finest. No one came to him empty-handed. And that's what Deuteronomy said. It was either Deuteronomy 34, it's in the feast book. It's either Deuteronomy 34 or Deuteronomy 16, because those are the two chapters that talk about the pilgrim feasts. The Shalosh Regalim, the three pilgrim feasts, the royal feasts. Okay, the pilgrims delivered their first fruits and they cut branches and vines to build booths along the streets and fields around the temple. Families camped in booths for 7 days. I cannot imagine that being less stressful than being at home. But it was still a vacation. It was probably really bonding, and you got to see a lot of people that you hadn't seen since the last pilgrim feast. But they camped to fulfill Leviticus 23:42 and 43, and remember that God brought them out of Egypt, causing them to dwell in booths in the wilderness. Everyone built a sukkah to live in for the entire week of Sukkot. You know, when I would teach the feast days on television, I spent 2 hours on every feast, and I would show maybe 10 or 12 pictures of different Sukkot, and Sukkot is plural for sukkah, but in the Midwest, we can say sukkahs, and it'll be all right. So I would show all these pictures of sukkahs, and I would say things like, "Now this is an ugly sukkah." And then the host of the show would say, "An ugly sukkah? Tell me about that." And then some of them were just absolutely beautiful, beautiful sukkahs. And this is somewhere in the middle. This is about what our, this was not taken in our backyard, but it could have been, because that's about what our sukkah looks like. We know it's a temporary dwelling, and I'm going to tell a little funny story on my husband. He always took temporary very seriously because he doesn't have carpentry skills. I do. I'm the carpenter of the family. So he would put one little nail in for each one of those beams in the roof. And you know, the Sukkot is about praying for winter rains. You pray for rain. So it always rains during Sukkot. Does it here? And it'll always rain during Sukkot. Whether I've seen it in Israel, I've seen it in Texas. And the rain would start, and that sukkah would come falling down. And I'd say, "David, the sukkah is on the ground." He said, "Yes, it's a temporary dwelling." 1 year he didn't put any boards up there at all. He put string. because he doesn't like to build with wood. Okay, all right. Everyone would build a sukkah to live in, and they used branches to do that. Now, all over the world, we know that millions of people still build sukkot today. City dwellers, most people put them in their backyard, but city dwellers put them on their balconies. If you've ever been to Israel during the Feast of Tabernacles and you look up, everyone who lives in an apartment has one out on their balcony. Now, building a sukkah may seem like a silly idea to us, but this is a spiritual idea in heavenly places. And it's a simple picture for us. A flimsy sukkah can never provide enough shelter. It can't. It really can't shelter us. Only God is our true shelter and our provider. The sukkah leads us back to Him, and that's what it's designed to do. Okay, King Solomon dedicated the first temple during Sukkot, during the Feast of Tabernacles in 1 Kings 8. You know that temple was done 11 months earlier? He waited 11 months. He waited till Sukkot to dedicate it, even though it had been done 11 months earlier. He waited. Because it was the end of the growing season, farmers would be able to leave their fields. People from all over Israel would be able to come and not have any other commitments. So he waited until the Feast of Tabernacles to dedicate the temple. All right, and these are the Levites. The Levites would perform. Now let me tell y'all, that's a really good slide. So this is a very interesting projector. God bless it. But it's wiped out all the detail from the Levites. They're playing instruments, and they're singing, they're performing, they're singing the Hallel. And they would do that for all of the feasts. And that's where they stood, and that's how they did it. Okay, in the next slide, it's going to be probably difficult to see, but the priests are carrying the ark into the temple for the first time. Next, can you do the next slide, please? There it is. And you can see them carrying the ark into the temple. When they placed the ark inside the Holy of Holies, what happened? The Shekinah, the divine presence, the glory fell. It fell. It filled the temple so that the priests all fell down on their faces and no one could do their work. They couldn't do the temple service because of the glory of the living Elohim. That's in 1 Kings 8:10. Now, two special ceremonies at the temple were only held during the Feast of Tabernacles. And I want to tell you about these because they're pictures of future end-time prophecy. The first ceremony was the morning water ceremony. Every morning, the high priest went down to the pool of Siloam to draw living water, or Mayim, to pour on the altar. The pilgrims who accompanied him began leaping in the air and dancing, and they were singing Isaiah 12, verse 3, "With joy shall you draw waters from the wells of salvation." So with everybody leaping and dancing and singing, this was the most joyous event of the entire year. And what it says, what the rabbis wrote about this event is that if you have never seen rejoicing at the place of water drawing, you've never seen a real celebration in your entire life. And that's what they said. You know, they found those steps just about 5 years ago. They found the steps that they used to go down from the Temple Mount and draw. It was underground. It's under those streets to draw water for the morning water ceremony during Sukkot. Now, the water was poured on the altar as a visual prayer for rain. It's a way of praying for rain. And so today, the chief rabbis of Israel, the Ashkenazi and the Sephardic, will go down there together during Sukkot, and they'll pour water out at the Western Wall, and they'll pray for rain, which is really cool. I'm glad they're doing that. We all need prayer for rain. We should all be praying for more rain. One of the cups received water and the other one received wine. And I talked about that earlier because the water and the wine went down the side of the altar and all of that collected under the altar. And it dried there and formed dried patterns under there. But it was on the last and greatest day of the feast that they poured more than water. That's the day they added wine. And wine is a symbol of blood. Okay. Water is a symbol of spirit. So on the last and greatest day of the feast, they're pouring out the wine, they're pouring out the water. Yeshua's in the crowd. Now, you know, the Temple Mount's big. It's 35 acres. 350,000 people can stand up there. I don't know how big Indy is. How big are they? What's the population of Indianapolis? Okay, half of Indianapolis can stand up there at one time. That's how big it is. Yeshua's in the crowd, but he must have been pretty close to the court of priests where this ceremony was taking place. Because he cries out. You can see the wine. You see the red line? The wine was on the cup on this side. The water went on that side. And they're pouring out the wine. They're pouring out the water on the last and greatest day of the feast in John 7:37. And Yeshua cries out in a loud voice. He knew what people thought about that water, that it was living water. So what did he say? He said, if anyone's thirsty, let him come to me and drink. And out of his belly, out of his stomach, will flow rivers of living water. He was saying that he was the source of living water, and this is the day he said it. Now, the temple guards, those wonderful Levites, were too shocked to arrest him. Why didn't you arrest that man? Well, no one ever spoke as this man spoke. How could we arrest him? So, that, you know, they could not even arrest him when he said that at this ceremony. All of John chapters 7 through 9 take place at the Feast of Tabernacles. And Yeshua is there for the ceremonies. The second unique event of Sukkot was the evening lighting ceremony. They used to send the young priests up the ladder, up those ladders with those huge jars of olive oil strapped to their backs. There were four towering minaret or menorahs in the courtyard of the women. That's where they were located. And they would climb up. They would put those ladders against there, and they would climb up, and they would fill four lamps at the top of those four menorahs, 16 lamps, and each one of them held more than 7 gallons. So just imagine. I mean, each one of those would hold 28 gallons, so over 100 gallons every single night of Sukkot. They would climb the ladder until, it was quite a balancing act, until they had filled all the lamps with oil. And then on cue, the priests ignited the linen wicks in the giant lamps, and light would fill the night sky. The evening lighting ceremony would begin with the Levitical musicians on the steps and singing and dancing in the courtyard. Doesn't that look like fun? I want to see that. I do. The light of the towering menorahs could be seen for miles, and they illuminated every courtyard in Jerusalem. The Sukkot pilgrims understood that this was the light of the world. So it provided an ideal setting for Yeshua to reveal himself as the light of the world, which he did in John 8:12. Images from the Feast of Tabernacles are found in the future prophecies of Revelation. The Feast of Tabernacles is the final ingathering of the yearly harvest. Therefore, it depicts the final ingathering of souls in Revelation 7, 9 through 17. People from every nation, tongue, tribe, all across the world in the future gather to celebrate the Feast of Tabernacles. This is a requirement in Zechariah 14:16. And we see them in Revelation 7, 9, waving palm branches. Those are the branches of Sukkot. So they're celebrating the Feast of Tabernacles here in Revelation in the future. They're singing, salvation belongs to our God, in Revelation 7:10, recalling the cry of Hosanna from Psalm 118, verse 25, a song that they sung at the temple during Sukkot. Also, the prophetic promise of springs of living water in Revelation 7:17 alludes to the morning water ceremony of Sukkot. The promise of continuous light of God's glory in Revelation 21:23 alludes to the evening lighting ceremony. But the ultimate fulfillment of the Feast of Tabernacles is in Revelation 21:3. In Revelation 21:3, it says, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the tabernacle of God is now with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will be with them as their God.'" Hallelujah. Future Feast of Tabernacles. And for the Messianic Kingdom. Now, you know, we know the Messianic Kingdom goes on for 1,000 years. It will begin in conjunction with a future Feast of Tabernacles. Now, how long is Tabernacles? 7 days. The eighth day is Shemini Atzeret, which is the eighth day of Solemn Assembly. The ninth day is Simchat Torah. So it's the longest festival of the year, and somewhere in there, in a future year, we will see the Messianic Kingdom begin. Zechariah 14:16 declares, "Then everyone who survives of all the nations that have come against Jerusalem shall go up year after year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and to keep the Feast of Tabernacles." Hallelujah. It is interesting that in the morning water ceremony at the temple, prayers were offered for rains to come, and in this coming age, a lack of rain is the punishment if you don't go up and celebrate tabernacles, according to Zechariah 14:17, the very next verse. In spite of this punishment, the coming age will be characterized by great shalom. Ferocious animals and meek lambs are going to dine on vegetarian meals together. And the average lifespan in this coming era will be hundreds of years. A man's years will be like the years of a grand old tree, according to Isaiah 65, verse 22. The feast days have a past, they have a present, and they have a future. History hinges on the feast days. They are celebrated today as celebrations or appointments with God, but they describe aspects of future end times prophecy. God brings us to himself and the fullness of the Messianic Kingdom through his feast days. So when we celebrate the fall feasts, they really are rehearsals. When we wave palm branches, sometimes those are hard to get at this time of year. If you live in the city and you don't have a palm growing on your back patio, you go to the florist and you try to get them, but you end up having to buy a palm plant, usually from Home Depot, just to cut the branches off of it and use it for Sukkot. We've done that more than 1 year. But every time we do that, we're looking forward to that verse in Revelation, when every nation, tongue, and tribe will wave the palm branches of Sukkot. It's a glorious time, and we have so much to look forward to. That is what I wanted to share about future end times prophecy in the feast days. I could not be more excited about what's ahead for us on the Father's calendar. He's got wonderful things ahead for us. And the thing that we looked at last night, the way I ended the menorah presentation last night, was to say, fear not. Yeshua says, fear not. Fear not, little flock, for it's the Father's good will to give you the kingdom. What kingdom? The future kingdom that comes to earth in the Messianic age that begins in relation with the fall feasts. So thank you very, very much. I'm just so excited about this time, and I think he's got great things for us. I also think that if we stay close with him, we're going to hear his voice behind us saying, this is the way. Walk in it. And we need that. We need him to tell us, don't go home tonight. Someone is outside your house and they're going to kill you. Don't go home tonight. Or go down this road. Go down that road. Turn right here. Don't we need him? Don't we need to hear him say that? We do. And we can trust him because he knows the beginning of a thing from the end of a thing. Thank you.